Johnny and Dolly. The team is supported by AbleAuctions.ca. Closing your business? We can help.
Just ahead of John Shannon, one of our guests of the day. Delaney's OK Tire in Langley inbox, also the sponsor of our Old Man Kane,
yeah,
which I haven't used in a long time. I should have used it
well,
when we had that.
You should have used it when you announced the junior
put Coles player in our argument. Johnny Victoria, Donnie is going to trade Rick for the Excalibur. We're talking about a hockey player being traded for a van.
Oh, the Excalibur.
A bus.
What a great van. So much velvet and room. And
let's focus on that velvet. Speaking of which, I don't know what the segue is there. He likes the movie Blue Velvet because there was blue velvet in Excalibur. I'm not sure
if he does or not.
Dennis Hopper.
Dennis Hopper was in there.
Isabella Rossellini.
Oh,
Kyle MacLachlan.
Dennis
great
Hopper.
Show.
Yep.
John Shannon joining us now, we hope. NHL analyst, co-host of the Bob McCowan podcast. How are you, sir?
David Lynch is not one of my favorite guys. I'm not a David Lynch guy. So
you don't like his movies, or have you met him? Is there a story there?
No, I don't like his movies. You know,
okay.
I don't like his movies. But when you're talking about trading Rick for something inanimate, were you starting to talk about Jake Milford being traded for two Jack Adams nets? Remember that?
No, I don't remember that. Tell us about it.
Oh yeah, sure. The famous general manager of the Vancouver Canucks when I started doing Hockey Night in Canada there, Jake Milford, Eddie Shore traded him when he was a player for two Jack Adams official NHL nets so that they could put him and use them in the Springfield Arena.
Wow.
There are all sorts of Eddie Shore stories out there, and Don Cherry can tell you most of them. Hey, John, what do you think Jim Rutherford and Bruce Boudreau, at five straight wins, what do you think they've done for the Canucks? What's their impact been?
I'm not sure that we've seen any impact that Jim has had other than being around and obviously blessing the hiring of Bruce when Francesco asked him whether he wanted to work with Bruce. What I think Bruce has done, quite frankly, is taken the reins out of the hands of somebody else and let the players believe in themselves and have fun. You know, it's funny, we had a long talk with Bruce this morning about what he's done. And basically, he would tell you that almost every aspect of the game he's changed because he'd rather lose 6-5 than try to win 2-1. And so you're going to see the defensemen rushing up the puck more. You want players like Besser and Pettersson to shoot the puck at will. He's basically allowing the players to play the game. And obviously, the confidence has come back and paying off.
How much do you think players appreciate that, John, in this era of systems?
I think, first of all, I think they appreciate the relief of it. You know, it's always the case when you have a coach that is overly structured or very structured, then the next coach can come in and play it that way. Quite frankly, I think we've seen it with the team that Vancouver played last night with Columbus after 6 years of John Tortorella. Brad Larsen has his team playing a much more open style, albeit they understand some of the stuff that Tortorella preached, but the Blue Jackets are playing a much better brand of, more entertaining brand of hockey. The most famous one in the NHL was in Florida after Roger Nielsen was fired as coach there. They put Doug McClain behind the bench and Doug just let the boys play and they went all the way to the Stanley Cup final. So it's something that has had history and occurrences in the NHL. There's a lot of things that Travis put in place as the coach that I'm sure the players still remember. But now they're on the ice and they're not thinking. They're just acting instinctively and it's paying off for the Canucks.
John, you know Jim Rutherford. You've known him a long time. Okay, so he's 72 coming to Vancouver. A lot of questions about autonomy. Do you see this guy like, talk about the autonomy situation with him, Francesco, your thoughts on it.
Well, I mean, it's funny. Jim in his press conference talked about managing up.
Yeah.
I think that Jim manages up brilliantly. always has, whether it was with Peter Karmanos, whether it was with Mario and Ron in Pittsburgh. And I think that once you learn how to manage up, then you actually gain autonomy. And in both places, Jim had that type of opportunity to make changes when that he felt were necessary to put a winner on the table. And I would suggest that he's in a much similar scenario than in Vancouver that he was in both of the other places. There is no doubt in my mind that part of the working agreement between the two, and Jimmy would be straightforward, is saying, listen, if I'm going to come, I'm going to be in charge. Mm-hmm. I need to be able to make those changes. And whether that be in the front office, whether that be on the ice with Bruce and the coaching staff helping, I think that Jim has the autonomy. I think that that's the one thing that he would want and demand anywhere he would go. Because I do think, even though he made it sound like he wasn't going to get another job, I do believe that there were going to be other opportunities for Jim Rutherford.
John, quickly, COVID is starting to hit a lot of teams. Your thoughts there in the Olympics? I mean, my goodness, we're in a bit of a mess right now.
We are. We are. The good news is that most of the cases of COVID are asymptomatic or minor symptoms because people are vaccinated. That's a positive. And, you know, we're going to take this day by day. I mean, with two NFL teams, they've shut down their training facilities. The Flames now, I think, at 27 people within their organization have tested positively. Carolina still has two guys at the hotel in Vancouver, two more guys at the hotel in Minnesota before they went home. So they're going to have to go back to the protocols that kept it safe for everybody. And I don't think the pause is the next step. What might be pushing back and being pushed back by public health authorities is the amount of people in arenas. That might be the next step in all of this.
Yeah, enhanced protocols for now. What about the Olympics, John? Going, not going? What's your gut feeling?
My gut says no. My gut says no as the players start to ask questions. They have another call today at 2 o'clock Pacific time with the Players Association to discuss it. They've already had two. They had two on Monday. But I think the more and more players figure out that if they do catch COVID in China and they're there for 3 to 5 weeks and they may be at a hotel, they may be at a hospital, and they're going to miss games. I don't think the money issue is going to be a problem because the Federation will support a little bit of that. But if they're going to miss games for their own teams, I think they have to have a lot of concern. The other thing that hasn't come out, guys, is we haven't heard a lot from the families.
Yeah.
The families of these players are going to have a voice in all of this decision-making over the Christmas holidays.
Yeah. John, thanks for this. Thanks for the Jake Milford nugget. We appreciate it. We'll talk to you next week.
Have a good day, boys.
You bet.